Well, I was delighted that the Canadian Senate finally passed the bill that the House of Commons passed months ago to give us a little bit of free speech back, passing Bill C-304. But yesterday, at the same time as they gave freedom of speech a boost, well, they crushed accountability for Canada's labor unions by voting against Bill C-377. We've talked about that bill before, and joining us now from Ottawa to explain what went wrong last night is our friend Russ Hiebert. He's the Member of Parliament from South Surrey, White Rock, Cloverdale, and he's the author of this bill. Welcome back to the show, Russ.
Thanks, Ezra. Good to be here.
Well, I mean, I finally felt good about the Senate for the first time in months when they did the right thing on free speech, but I was really surprised that the Tory-dominated Senate sent back to the House of Commons your bill on union accountability. I'm shocked by that because I can't imagine what good faith conservative would be against transparency for union members' money. What went wrong?
Well, Ezra, I'm not exactly sure because I was just as shocked and surprised as you were with the vote that happened yesterday. It had been my hope that the majority of the senators would have seen the value of transparency and accountability, especially at a time like now. And we had gone through this process for 2 years on the elected House of Commons side, where we had the committees look at it, we'd had expert witnesses testify, we'd made some amendments to improve the bill. And then yesterday, it all seemed to unravel with an amendment that really does not even intend or pretend to improve the bill. It was really quite a shock.
Well, now, I think the fact that you're shocked is, I mean, I'm shocked. I'm just an outside observer. I take interest in this matter from time to time. But you were the author of the bill. It sounds like maybe things were going on the Senate side under your radar. Let me ask you this. Were senators lobbied on this by the unions? We interviewed various union leaders who said they were going to war on this. This was going to be a big fight. Did they lobby the senators? Have you looked at the lobbyist registry to see if the unions just went door to door twisting arms, or what happened?
Well, I have no doubt that the labor organizations in Canada did put up a big fight. They talked the talk. They said they would. I expect that they have. At the same time, you know, it's just hard to predict. Less than a week ago, we thought things were going well. I had spoken with many of my colleagues in the Senate, and we had addressed their concerns during the Banking Committee's hearings, where we had 3 weeks. Of course, there was a lot of anti-transparency and accountability people who came forward to try and prevent the bill from happening. But we felt that we had addressed the major concerns, and yet we were caught off guard yesterday when it happened.
You know, on the screen right now, we're scrolling the names of those conservative senators who chose to use their unelected position to countermand their elected brothers and sisters in the House of Commons. That's what bugs me so much. I'm looking at some of these names: Hugh Siegel, Norman Doyle, almost all these names. Betty Unger is a rare exception, she being an elected senator from Alberta. José Verneuil. Many of these used to be MPs or candidates for the House of Commons, so they at one time respected democracy, but now that they're stuffed in the Senate, they say, well, we don't have to listen to the elected House. We know better. There's a hubris here that's not too separate from the furor over their own accountability over financial matters. I think this tonally is just awful for these senators to do, but I guess they don't give a damn since you can't fire them, right?
Mm. Well, you know, I'm not going to speak to their motives or their intentions behind the amendment, but when I look at the face of the amendment, the fact that it guts the bill so substantially, making sure that it would only apply to less than 1% of unions in Canada under its revised form, and what they would have to disclose is next to nothing. It makes me wonder, you know, clearly this was not an attempt to improve the bill. Something else is going on here that I can't put my finger on. People are speculating, but my hope is that as a country and as a parliament, we haven't lost our commitment to accountability and transparency. We know that Canadians, 83% of them, tell us that they want this kind of transparency. Workers, even more so, 86%, want this information to be public. So I hope we can bring it back unamended and get it through next time, or I guess there's always the option that the government could take up the bill.
We only have a few moments left. Can you tell us the steps that happen now? So they voted to send it back to the House of Commons to be voted on in this revised form. Is that what happens now?
Yes, so it's been amended, and it passed third reading in its amended state, got sent back to the House of Commons, and now the House would have to, my colleagues and I would have to decide what to do with the amendments that got the bill, and my hope is that we can send it back without amendment and get it through the Senate. I'm interested in talking to my colleagues in the Senate to find out firsthand their particular concerns, because I hadn't heard from these individuals, so I want to hear what their concerns are, and hopefully we can address it next time around.
I have to tell you, if the roles were reversed, I mean, the bill that I've been hoping for and championing in my own capacity going back many years with this free speech bill, and if it had passed the House of Commons but was sunk by unelected, unaccountable senators for life in the Senate, I would be beyond rage right now. Not at the substance of the decision, but about the hubris and the imperial attitude that unelected, unaccountable, appointed for life senators know better than the House. Like, had I cheered the victory in the House and then had defeat in the Senate, that would turn me into a Senate abolitionist. Last word to you. How do you feel about the Senate? Does this increase your resolve that the Senate itself be reformed?
Well, I agree with the Prime Minister. I think if we cannot reform the Senate to make it elected, that abolishing it would be the next best option.
Russ, we're out of time. Thanks for joining us today, folks.